In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you got my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When the solid ground is falling out from underneath my feet, between the black skies and my red eyes, I can barely see. When I'm feeling like I've been let down by my friends and my family, I can hear the rain reminding me. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you got my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. Hopes and dreams are far from me, and I'm running out of faith. See the future I picture slowly fade away. When the tears of pain and heartache are pouring down my face, I find my peace in Jesus' name. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you got my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. Just don't know how I'm gonna make ends meet. I did my best now, I'm scared to death. We might lose everything. When a sickness takes my child away, there's nothing I can do. My only hope is to trust in you. I trust you, Lord. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you got my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. You remain in control. In the middle of the war, you got my soul. You alone are the anchor. My sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm.
Well, good morning, everyone. What a beautiful day it is that the Lord has made, and how wonderful it is to be gathered in this place for worship this morning. We're so thankful to see each and every one of you as we gather for worship. We have a lot of exciting things coming up as we're in the throes of summer, but before I get into the announcements at this time, I would like to invite you, if you are sitting at the end of the aisle, to please take the friendship pad. Take some time to fill that out and pass that on down, and especially take some time, if this is your first Sunday at St. John's, to fill that out. Related to the friendship pad, though, going into my first announcement, I want to make mention that after this service, immediately concluding this service, we're going to be doing our quarterly Getting to Know St. John session today. That's going to take place right here. If you are thinking about joining St. John's as a member, if you have been coming recently and just want to know more about the programs that we have here at the church, or just want some more information about how you can get plugged in and about the history of our church or anything that's on your mind, we invite you to stick around afterwards. This will be a great time for you to get some of your questions asked and to find out some more ways that you can get further plugged into our church with all the exciting things that we have going on and coming up as well. So that will take place immediately after the service, and we'll still be here in the Faith Center. So all you got to do is just stick around. Some things I want to make mention of is our Grove Children's Ministry will meet tonight from 5 to 6:30 in the gym for an ice cream social, a special Bible lesson, and some fun times. Please make sure that drop-off is at the gym, and pickup will be at the playground afterwards at 6:30. So 5 to 6:30 this evening. We also the youth will be meeting tonight from 5 to 6:30 in the Faith Center for a fun night of manhunt. It's going to be a wonderful, as we're in our summer sessions, it's going to be a lot of fun Sundays coming up. But tonight they will meet again from 5 to 6:30. And there will also be a meeting at Chick-fil-A on Monday at 11:30 for a treat lunch and a special time of fellowship. So if you're part of the youth, please note those. We want to make mention that all rising ninth graders are invited to come and to bring a friend for a lock-in that's going to be held here on Wednesday the 29th. Drop-off is at 8 in the Faith Center, and pickup is at 8 a.m. On the 30th. So looking forward to that. A lot of exciting things coming up with our youth. And please note that the summer calendar is out with everything that they have coming up as well. We want to especially make mention that on July 3rd, the Sunday before the 4th of July, will be our special 4th of July worship service. That day, we are only going to have one service. It's going to be a combined service that's going to be held in the sanctuary at 10 a.m., and it will be our special 4th of July worship service. We look forward to that, and related to that is make sure you check with your Sunday school teachers to see. I think most of them are probably canceling Sunday school that Sunday, but make sure that you know that that's going to be during the 10 o'clock hour. And related to that also, that Monday on 4th of July, the church office will be closed. And that is all that I have. So, friends, I invite us to please stand and let us continue our worship this morning.
I caught a glimpse of your splendor in the corner of my eye. Most beautiful thing I'd ever seen. It was like a flash of lightning reflected off the sky, and I know I'll never be the same. Show me your glory, send down your presence. I want to see your face. Show me your glory. Majesty shines about you. I can't go on without you, Lord. When I climb down this mountain and get back to my life, I won't settle for ordinary things. I'm gonna follow you forever and for all of my days. I won't rest till I see you again. Show me your glory. Send down your presence. I wanna see your face. Show me your glory. Majesty shines about you. I can't go on without you, Lord. Show me your glory. Send down your presence. I want to see your face. Show me your glory. Shines about you. I can't go on without you, Lord.
I invite you to remain standing as together we affirm our faith with the words of the song, We Believe.
the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. Given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. And He's coming back. He's coming back again. He's coming back again. We believe.
Friends, as we have gathered here this morning for worship, as we have confessed our faith together, at this time I would like to invite us all to go before the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, this morning we praise your name in this beautiful day that you have made and this day that you have called us forth. May our time of worship remind us once again that it is your unfailing grace, your merciful love that goes before us each day, that lives within us through your Spirit and calls us forward as bearers of the name of Jesus. Today, O Lord, we wait once again upon your hope, but we rejoice right now in the present, in the freedom that has been secured through the gospel of our Lord Jesus. For through his death, we are given life. And through his resurrection, we experience his glory now and forevermore. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, we continue forward toward the goal of your holiness, towards the goal of your love, and to the home in which you've beckoned us forward, the home of the new heavens and the new earth, where you will make all things new. And we live in that newness today through your Spirit. So, Lord, we know today that your love is secured, that our hope is rest assured, and that your love will never fail us. No matter what darkness it is that we face this day, no matter what burdens it is that we carry on our shoulders, you have called us forth with broken chains and burdens lifted. For you said your yoke is easy and your burden is light. So, Lord, may we receive with open arms your truth this morning, as we continue to be your servants in a world that is so broken and in so need of Jesus' love. Lord, we give you thanks and praise together as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught his own disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us for our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, I would like to invite our ushers to come forward for a time of tithes and offerings. Let us give as God has so graciously given to us.
To win this war, I confess my hands are weary. I need Thank you. Our scripture this morning comes from Luke's Gospel, the 9th chapter. The subheading is The Cost of Following Jesus. Verse 57. As they were walking along the road, a man said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. And Jesus replied, Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. He said to another man, Follow me. But the man replied, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. And Jesus said to him, Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. And still another said, I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. And Jesus replied, No one who puts his hands to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You know, there's a story told some years ago about how Satan wanted to trip up the church and try to deflect us from following in Jesus' path and being good disciples. And so Satan wanted to give a contest to his minions. And so the first one said, Satan, I've got an idea. I think it's a pretty good plan. If you want to trip up the church and keep the church from doing what the church needs to do, then you need to tell the church that there is no such thing as hell. You take away the whole notion of punishment and repercussions and, oh, it'll trip up the church and the church won't be near as desirous to follow you. Just tell the church there is no hell. And Satan said to the demon, that's a pretty good idea, but I need to listen to the other ideas first. And so the next demon stepped up and said, I've got an idea. Tell the church that there is no heaven. Take away any notion of reward and benefit and blessing eternity. Take away all that incentive, and the church will be distracted and will slip up and will be tripped up. And then Satan said, well, I've got one more to listen to. That's a good idea. There is no heaven. And that was a good idea. There is no hell. But let me listen to this last demon. So the last demon comes up and says, Satan, I've got a great plan. Here's what you do to trip up the church, to keep the church from doing what it's supposed to do. Tell the church there is no hurry. There is no hurry. Now, don't you think we live in a world when we need to be in a hurry about standing up for what's right and against what's wrong? Don't you think we live in a world where we need to be very industrious, or more than industrious, we need to be passionate about what we believe rather than playing defensive all the time, playing on defense? Isn't it time that the church gets on offense? Just think about it. I know as Methodists, and particularly as Christian people, we think that being nice is our goal in life. Oh, let's just be nice. I mean, I've done many a children's sermon, and I'm looking forward to restarting children's sermons down here at front. And I've done many a children's sermon over the years. And if you boil down what most children's sermons are about, you know what they're about, don't you? Be nice. Be nice to your mom and daddy. Be nice to your brother and sister. Make up your bed. Be nice to your teachers. Just be nice. Maybe it's time for us to get our acts together, to get ourselves in gear, and to march forward in the midst of a crazy and mixed up world. You see, I see this passage of Scripture, and I noticed before the Scripture passage that I read, in Luke chapter 9, verse 51, it says, as the time approached for Jesus to be taken up to heaven, it says, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem. He resolutely. And in some translations, it says he set his face toward Jerusalem. That is a determined plan. It reminds me of what engineers do, especially civil engineers. As I think about civil engineers, as they do a lot of work with highway planning and road planning, they try to get from point A to point B in as quickly a way as possible, and as safely away as possible. Point A to point B, as quickly as possible and as safely as possible. On the other hand, I look at the church and I look at myself and my own Christian life as a disciple, and I'm more like a guy who follows a cow path. Now, I don't know if you know anything about cow paths, but there's a big difference between a cow path and a civil engineering set of plans. A civil engineering set of plans has a very orderly, safe, quick way to do things. But you know what cows do? They just mosey along and meander, and they cut here and they cut there, and there's no rhyme or reason for why did they take this path or that path. Some will even tell you, if you've been to the city of Boston, that the streets in the city of Boston are so discombobulated, they're so mixed up and so out of sorts because of Boston Common in the middle of the city. Boston Common in the middle of the city, from colonial times on the peninsula where the city of Boston is located, Boston Common was where everybody in their surrounding houses would let their cows loose to go and graze, and free graze, free is a big word, to free graze at Boston Common. And so all these cows who made their way to Boston Common, going this way and that way and this way and that way and coming from all those different houses, those cow paths became streets eventually. And so that's why the streets in Boston look more like spaghetti than they do anything else. It's interesting, isn't it? Cow paths or civil engineering, which way resembles our discipleship path. Do we follow the straight and narrow? Jesus says, straight is the way and narrow is the way that leads to eternal life, but broad is the way that leads to destruction. Cow paths are easy to create. They don't have a destination in mind so much as they keep their heads down. These cows keep their heads down and they don't look up, except I think we, as sort of like cows, we look up. We don't look forward to the destination, but we do catch ourselves glancing sideways to see what other people think. And we want to know how many likes we have on our post, or how many times our posts on Facebook have been reshared or reposted. And we want to have opinion polls about what's right and what's wrong. And we forget about the straight and narrow that's plainly put in this book, this collection of books we call the Bible. It is high time we quit acting like cows. You know what cows will do? Cows will find themselves on their usual meandering path. And if a tree has fallen over that path, you know what cows will do? They will cut another path around that tree. And long after that tree is either decayed and rotted and fallen away to nothing, or has been picked up and moved by some farmer or some other industrious person, cows will still go in that bend, even though there's no reason for them to go in a curve anymore. They're not that bright. Like us, they're almost like lemmings who just follow and follow and follow. Change is slow for cows. And it's even slower than that sometimes for the church. I mean, it's so easy for us to get distracted and keep from following Jesus' way. It is so easy. What are the seven last words of the dying church? Oh, it's famous. The seven last words of the dying church are, "We've never done it that way before." Oh, how sad is that? When Jesus wants to call us to an adventure of following Him, of following Him, it used to be in our family when we thought we were moving. We thought that there was a good chance that we were going to be moved by the bishop in a particular year. We knew that it was going to be trouble when Cindy, my wife, would start playing the song by Stephen Curtis Chapman, "Saddle Up Your Horses." We knew there was a good chance we were moving. Saddle up your horses. It's a great song. Some of you know the name of Joe Gibbs. Joe Gibbs, famous NFL football coach, but many of you know that he's also pretty good at being a NASCAR racing team owner, and he's won a bunch of Winston Cup Series trophies. He's done a grand job as a not only a football coach, but as a NASCAR team owner. Before he got into NASCAR, he liked to drive fast. I mean, who doesn't? But I'm not recommending that at all. But nevertheless, he liked to drive fast. And so he went to Charlotte Motor Speedway, and he wanted to have a test run around the track. He wanted to learn how to drive a NASCAR before he would invest the millions of dollars that he needed to invest to have his own racing team. So he hired an instructor, and the instructor had a special car, but before he even let Joe Gibbs in the car, he gave him some advice. He said, "Now, what's going to happen in this special car? This car is a skid car. What's going to happen is that you're going to gun it down the straightaway. You're going to speed up as fast as you can, and then you're going to hit that first curve, and you're going to start to skid. Your back tires are going to start skidding, and before you know it, you're going to lose control, and you're going to find yourself looking at the wall. And whatever you're looking at is where you're going to point the car. So wherever you're looking is where you're going to go. So I want to make sure that you don't look at the wall, you look at the track. You look at the track." So we've got this special car. It's called a skid car. And at the press of a button, I can put you in a skid at any moment. We do this to rookie drivers to see if they've got what it takes to make the snap decision to be able to avoid the wall and ruin the car and maybe hurt themselves, maybe even some fans up in the stands. So Joe Gibbs, he listens to all this about the car goes where you are looking. He knows the guy's going to put it into a skid, but he doesn't know when. He can't even see the button. And so he gets in the car. He goes down the straightaway. He gets over 125 miles an hour. And he heads to that first curve, and the guy presses the button, and the car starts skidding. And he's looking at the wall, and there it is. And the guy reaches over with both hands and jerks his head away from looking at the wall and looking back at the track and keeps him from wrecking. And Joe Gibbs Racing is now history, as they say. Wouldn't it be great? Wouldn't it be great if in the midst of our lives, Jesus would grab our heads when we're looking at something we shouldn't be looking at, when we're looking at the wall, when we're looking at disaster, when we're like cows on a cow path looking down and, or looking sideways to see what other people think about what we're doing, wouldn't it be great if Jesus would somehow just jerk our heads so that we would be focusing back on the straight and narrow? That's exactly what he does in this passage of Scripture, or tries to at least. He tells them, first of all, that he is setting his face to go to Jerusalem, that nothing is going to keep him from the straight and narrow going to that cross to die for our sins, my sins and yours. He is resolutely setting his face. And then he sees these people and he invites them to come along with him. There are these three guys. And the first one, oh, he sounds good. He says, Lord, I will go wherever you want me to go. I'll go wherever you want me to go. Oh, that sounds good, but talk is cheap. Because we know that he doesn't do anything. He doesn't follow Jesus. We got a lot of people who say all kinds of fancy things about their faith, you know. But then talk is cheap. And the second guy, he says, Lord, I'll follow you, but first let me go back and bury my father. Now that looks good. I mean, that's proper decorum. That's the way you ought to be. You ought to take care of your family when they're grieving. But Jesus says, let the dead bury their own dead, but you come and proclaim the kingdom of God. Because what happens, it's when we look good, when we have that proper decorum, we forget that nowhere in the New Testament does Jesus ever tell anybody that he's calling to become one of his followers, I want you to go home and I want you to sleep on it and think about it and get back to me tomorrow. Nowhere does Jesus say, I want you to go home and sleep on it and pray on it and think on it and get back with me tomorrow. No, when Jesus called Peter, James, and John, when they were in their boats out on the lake of Gennesaret or the Sea of Galilee, he says, come, follow me. And they immediately left their boats behind and followed Jesus. Every time Jesus called anybody, he didn't say, go home and think about it and pray about it and get back to me tomorrow. He wanted a decision right then and there. No. No wasting of time. And then the last guy said, somewhat like the second guy, let me first say goodbye to my family. Let me first say goodbye to my family. And that sounds good too, doesn't it? That looks good too, doesn't it? I mean, you know, everybody ought to have the chance to say goodbye to their family before they go off on this wild hair chase following this crazy guy from Nazareth named Jesus. You know, everybody ought to go say goodbye to their family. But on the other hand, remember that chorus we used to sing a long time ago? I've decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. Three times you say, I have decided to follow Jesus. And then twice you say, no turning back. No turning back. Remember that song? Do we mean it? Do we mean it? 20 years ago, I went on a mission trip to Bulgaria. I've been on mission trips all over. But I was on a mission trip in Bulgaria 20 years ago. We were digging a well, and we were trying to rebuild an orphanage in a little village called Strazda in Bulgaria. We flew into Varna, which is on the Black Sea. And man, it was horrible. It was sad. The Russians had left about 10 years before I made my trip there, but you could see the effects and the depression. There was a new Methodist church there, and they had hung a bell there that had been buried for 40 years or more while the Russians were in charge and the communists were in charge, and these Christian guys from this Methodist church that ended up being confiscated by the communists and turned into a playhouse of all things, a playhouse. And well, that shouldn't surprise many of you because some of you play at being a Christian. Wow, that was a little personal. But they turned it into a playhouse, and these guys went back after the Russians lost the USSR and lost their control over Bulgaria. And they dug up the bell and they rehung it in a rebuilt church. I was blessed to be able to walk up and see that bell and to hear it ring. And I'm telling you, you don't want to be close to a bell when it's ringing. I made a quick trip down the steps. But one other experience that I saw there that really shocked me. And it makes me think about Reverend Douglas as he just got ordained. You know, he went through all these hoops and things and all kinds of tests and, you know, everything else to try to figure out if he really meant what he meant when he said he wanted to become a minister. He made all these promises to uphold the scriptures. He made all these promises to follow our book of discipline and to keep it, and he agreed that it was right. That's what every Methodist minister does. I don't care what these nutcases do around this country of ours who say they are Methodists but don't believe in what we stand for. But frankly, these people in Bulgaria, they only asked one question. You had to answer pages and pages and pages and pages of questions, but they only had to answer one question, and that one question was this: when were you baptized? Now, I'm going to tell you, that'd be hard for me to do. I was baptized as an infant. I mean, I'm sure that there's a baptismal certificate somewhere, but I couldn't tell you. I know Mama told me that it was when I was about 3 months of age, something like that. But their one question is, when were you baptized? So I asked, why do you ask that question, when were you baptized? And they said, we asked that one question because the Russians took over Bulgaria in 1944. And they kept their communist atheistic regime in place until 1990, when the Soviet Union collapsed. So if people got baptized between 1944 and 1990, we knew that when they were baptized, they really meant it because they were risking their lives and they were risking their future. But anybody who was baptized after 1990, we've got a bunch of other questions to ask them to find out if they really meant it. So when you join the church, or if you haven't joined the church, this would be a fine time to do it. This would be a fine time to do it, to make a declaration in your life and in your family that you are going to follow Jesus' way, the civil engineer's way, that's point A to point B, from here to heaven, and not a cow path that leads you astray. But it's your choice. It's all of our choices. Do we want to put our hands to the plow and look back? You know what happens when you put your hands to the plow and look back? What are the furrows going to look like? They're going to be just like a cow path. They're going to be all over the place. Do you want to put your hands to the plow and look back, or do you want to put your hands to the plow of being a Christian and follow it to the end? There's a wonderful author. His name is Sam Walter Foss, F-O-S-S, who has painted a picture that I think sums up this passage of Scripture and sums up this sermon, frankly. It really offers a message of challenge to anybody who would be willing to keep staying on the cow path instead of following the adventuresome, straight and narrow path, risky path, exciting path that Jesus offers. The title of the poem is called The Calf Path. The Calf Path. One day through the primeval wood, a calf walked home, as good calves should, but made a trail all bent askew, a crooked trail, as all calves do. Since then, 300 years have fled, and I infer the calf is dead. But still he has left behind his trail, and thereby hangs my moral tale. The trail was taken up next day by a lone dog that passed that way, and then a wise bellwether sheep pursued the trail over vale and steep, and drew the flock behind him too, as good bellwether sheep always do. And from that day, o'er hill and glade, through those old woods a path was made, and many men wound in and out, and dodged and turned and bent about, and uttered words of righteous wrath, because 'twas such a crooked path. But still they followed, do not laugh, the first migrations of that long-dead calf. And though this winding woodway stalked, because he wobbled when he walked. This forest path became a lane that bent and turned again. This crooked lane became a road where many a poor horse with his load toiled on beneath the burning sun and traveled some 3 miles in one. And thus a century and a half they trod the footsteps of that calf. The years passed on in swiftness fleet. The road became a village street, and this before men were aware, a city's crowded thoroughfare. And soon the central street was this of a renowned metropolis. And men 2 centuries and a half trod in the footsteps of that long dead calf. Each day 100,000 men rout followed that zigzag calf about, and o'er his crooked journey went the traffic of a continent. 100,000 men were led by one calf near 3 centuries dead. They follow still his crooked way and lose 100 years in a day. For thus such reverence is lent for well-established precedent. A moral lesson this might teach were I ordained to call and call to preach. For men are prone to go it blind along the calf paths of the mind. For men are prone to go it blind along the calf paths of the mind. And work away from sun to sun to do what other men have done. They follow in the beaten track and out and in and forth and back, and still their devious course pursue to keep the path that others do. They keep the path a sacred groove along which all their lives they move. But how the wise old wood gods laugh who saw the first primeval calf. Ah, many things this tale might teach, but I'm not ordained to preach. I am, but I didn't write the poem. So the choice is ours: to follow the straight and narrow, the adventuresome, risky business called discipleship, to put our hand to the plow and not look back, and follow Jesus and to go wherever he says for us to go. Or our choice is to become like a lonesome calf, moseying and meandering and just following along without any care. Nothing left for us to do but to become the prey of a wolf in his lair. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, help us to dedicate our hearts and minds to you this day. Help us to dedicate our lives to you, that we will not follow the ways of the world, but that we will follow the ways of the master planner, the chief engineer, the one who's more than civil, who loves us all and holds us dear, the one who wants to forgive us and make us new, to give us a new calling to do. Help us, Lord Jesus, to have the courage to put aside the destructive walls and the temptations that would cause us to crash, and help us to follow you, no matter where you lead. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I invite you to stand now as we sing together.
Sorrowful trouble now, thought, how will you ever get so far down, and how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty and children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist in heaven. And I said, God, why don't you do something? He said, I did. I created you. If not us, then who? If not me and you right now, it's time for us to do something. If not now, then when? For us to do something. So tired of talking about how we are God's hands and feet, but it's easier to say than to be. We live like angels of apathy who tell ourselves it's all right, somebody else will do something. Well, I don't know about you, but I'm sick and tired of life with no desire. I don't want a flame, I want a fire. I want to be the one who stands up and says, I'm gonna do something. If not us, then who? If not me and you right now, well, it's time for us to do something, yeah. If not now, then when will we see an end to all this pain? Well, it's not enough to do nothing. It's time for us to do something. We are the salt of the earth. We are a city on a hill. Shine, 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 shine. We're never gonna change the world by standing still. No, we won't stand still. No. If not us, then who? If not me and you right now, well, it's time for us to do something, yeah. If not now, then when will we see an end to all this pain? Well, it's not enough to do nothing. for us to do something.
Na, 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 na.
It's time for us to do something.
Na, 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 na.
It's time for us to do something.
Na, 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 na.
It's time for us to do something.
Amen. It's time for us to do something. No more lollygagging, no more detouring, no more meandering around and moseying. It's time for us to do something. And so may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and inspire you to do something. Amen. Go in peace.
We are the salt of the earth. We are a city on a hill. Shine, 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 shine. We're never gonna change the world by standing still. No, we won't stand still. No, if not us, then who? If not me and you? Well, it's time for us to do something, yeah.
If not now, then when will we see an end to all this pain?
Well, it's not enough to do nothing. It's time for us to do something.
Na, 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 na.
It's time for us to do something.
Na, 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 na.